I know that Dana wished my wife a happy birthday on
I sure night. Did. And she apparently got my message.
She did. There you go.
We received the message we wanted to receive.
That's what you need. That's what you need is two wives.
We were trying to sing, but you wouldn't let us sing.
That's right. Well, that was the call to order. Number two is approve the minutes of July 8th, 2010. I was not here. I was in Florida with Mr. Barnhill.
Being resuscitated.
No, actually, I was still quite alive at that point. It was a few days later. It was a month ago today, in fact.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Very good. Number three is presentation of the Goose Creek area traffic study.
This is the study that we entered into with Wilbur Smith concerning the Goose Creek area, trying to see what we might be able to do to mitigate problems during the closures of I-65, for I-65 widening and Goose Creek interchange reconstruction. Brad Thompson and Hollis Loveday with Wilbur Smith will be doing this presentation. So I turn it over to Brad. And we do have copies of the presentation to give you.
Is that true? Margaret, is it raining outside?
It's going to. I've been watching the judge shows, and they said.
You know how much money she made?
$43 million.
I saw that, something like that.
Judge
Judy.
And these judge people on TV.
She makes how much?
$43 million.
A year?
A year.
Something like that.
I think that's ridiculous.
Anyway, Judge, what's his name? Alex was on a while ago, and they said severe thunderstorms on the way. So that's what he's talking about.
Here?
Here.
Oh. Who knows?
All right.
All right. As far as I know, this is working okay, I guess. But as Mr. Parker mentioned, my name is Brad Thompson. I've seen you all several times over the past few months related to the major thoroughfare plan. And really, I guess a few months ago, this study spawned out of the major thoroughfare plan and the work we were doing there. So we got together and started working on doing some data collection analysis to look at really the impacts they're going to result from the I-65 widening and the Goose Creek interchange. We've looked at a couple of different scenarios that Hollis will get into in just a minute. But in the end, what we're ultimately trying to do is identify some potential strategies for helping the city in regards to handling the additional traffic that's going to result from, some most likely in construction, some temporary lane closures, those types of things that is going to feed traffic onto your more localized roadway network. But we appreciate the opportunity, and we're getting fairly close to the end of this, so we wanted to come and kind of update you all with regard to some of the findings so far and get your input before we kind of got into that realm of finalizing some of our recommendations that result from the study. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Hollis Loveday, who's out of our Knoxville office.
There is a PowerPoint that Eric's trying to get pulled up for you.
Having technical difficulties.
So, hopefully in a minute it'll be there.
I guess we can go ahead and just, I guess it's coming up now.
Okay, so this guy walks into a bar with a duck.
Well, I tell you what, we'll get started.
Come back up.
Okay. Thank you for allowing us to be here today. It looks like we're getting close here.
There we go.
Now I just need
not
the,
it.
Now, well, that's yeah, now that. I've got control. Now I just need to get the presentation pop up.
So, is this the first showing of the presentation? Has it been shown?
No,
it has not been.
This is the world premiere.
This is the premiere.
Yeah. Well, we've seen.
Okay. Dan said he'd see the premiere.
We've seen the preliminary.
We met with David and Eric earlier.
Probably longer than what you're going to see. So.
Yeah, we went through it in painstaking detail. I guess you could say about a week ago.
Well, there's my email. I just got to find the email that Brad sent me earlier. Technology.
Take a little time. Must be that storm.
Is that a PC?
just checking.
Brad Thompson. See what we got to put up with? There we go. Well, maybe not. Here we are.
All right, there it is. Okay. So today is the 12th, and it's good to be here today, and we'll try to just go through this, and I'd be happy to entertain questions and comments as we go along. If you want to do that, we can just be informal and talk about our findings. So let's go to the next slide. This is a summary of the activities that we've performed so far. It started out with a fairly intense data collection that took place in February and March of this year. Actually, we had some problems because of snow, and I remembered incorrectly when I talked to David earlier about this. It was actually February through March, and we had a couple of snow days that required us to postpone the data collection, but because school was out and things were not normal. We did a lot of intersection turning movement counts around the I-65 and Murfreesboro Interchange and throughout the study area. We got traffic signal information, and we also got intersection laneage to look at existing conditions. We decided to select 2015 as our analysis year because that's most likely the time when the Goose Creek Interchange would be closed. And we made use of the travel demand model to help us to predict traffic that would be in place in 2015. We looked at land use and other things that would have happened by then to give us a good baseline condition. Next slide.
Hollis, let me chime in and say one thing Hollis mentioned with the interchange being closed. It's not necessarily saying that the interchange is going to be closed. I don't believe TDOT's made any decisions with regard to that yet, but that's how we were approaching this, was looking at it with the interchange open, and also if the interchange were to be closed, what would be the differences? So I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah, and then that's what this slide here shows. It shows the scenarios that we examined. The first one was 2015 with the interchange open, and then 2015 with the interchange closed, and then the third scenario was the interchange closed in 2015, but Carruthers Parkway extended to the south.
And let me interrupt. The closed interchange means the ramps are closed. We still have the ability in doing this modeling that you can cross the interstate.
But you can't get on or off.
Cannot get on and off the interstate at Goose Creek, but you'd be able to cross at Goose Creek, yes.
What's going to be happening to the interstate?
The interstate is going to be widened, and then they're going to be reconfiguring or reconstructing the interchange at Goose Creek. It's going up to like, I forgot, 10 lanes, 8 or 10 lanes.
Eight plus auxiliary.
And the bridge across the interstate at Goose Creek will be widened, and the ramps and
etc. But the interstate will be open.
The interstate will have lanes open, yes. But then also for the interchange itself, our understanding, what we've been told from TDOT, is the bridge for the interchange has to be raised. So they will be doing some raising of that bridge as they do this work. But they should be able to do the work for the interchange and keep, and that's the scenario we're looking at, is keep lanes crossing the interchange, or crossing the interstate, I'm sorry. So when what is being discussed here is a closed interchange, it means that.
And I guess to further expand on that, TDOT's plan right now is to widen to just north of the interchange. And I mean, they're hoping to be able to start construction on that early next year. So that section, at least in this assumption, would be complete. And so it would be four lanes north of the interchange with under the interchange and further south under construction at this point. So it would be open, it would be widened just north of it and under construction at the interchange.
You know, I was able to confirm today, talking with TDOT, that that is scheduled for letting in September, the section, the 3.3 miles north of Goose Creek Interchange.
Sorry for the interruption.
Sure, no problem. Next slide. This is the study area. The red dots represent the intersections that we studied, and these are where we made the counts. We also got counts from TDOT for the ramps and for I-65. So this primary study area included Lewisburg and Columbia, Murfreesboro Road, and of course Goose Creek, so it's a pretty large study area covering most of the major, if not all the major intersections that we think would be impacted by the reconstruction of the interchange. And this is an interesting slide, and it may be a little bit difficult to see, but I guess the question that I had is really, where's the traffic going to go if the interchange is closed? What's going to happen with it? And so the travel demand model was useful in helping us predict the change in traffic patterns as a result of the closure of the interchange, if it were to be closed during construction. And again, it's a little bit difficult to see, but most of the traffic is going to make its way to Murfreesboro Road and use Royal Oaks and Mackhatcher Parkway to get to Lewisburg and to Columbia Avenue.
Yeah.
This one.
There we go.
So if you look at this slide, here's Royal Oaks, and this is the I-65 corridor, of course. This is Murfreesboro, and this is Royal Oaks. This is Mackhatcher there, and there's Lewisburg. So what's happening is the model is predicting that most traffic will get on and off at the Murfreesboro interchange and make its way to the south instead of course, using Goose Creek. So Royal Oaks, Mackhatcher, and those intersections and those roads are going to see the largest impact. Interestingly enough, also Cool Springs sees an increase in traffic as a result of the closure of the interchange. So some traffic is also choosing to get off at that Cool Springs interchange and working its way to the south. So that's this slide that shows what would happen if the interchange is closed. The next one builds on this, the first slide, by showing the impacts if Carruthers Parkway is extended to the south. And so the red numbers are identical to the numbers that were on the previous slide. The black numbers show the redistribution of traffic if Cool Springs, or rather Carruthers Parkway, is extended. And you see that in 2015, the model is predicting that Carruthers extended would realize about 3,800 vehicles per day. So that's 2015, and that of course includes the scenario with the interchange closed. So here we're trying to again just track the impacts, and no doubt about it, the extension of Carruthers does have a positive impact on the roads that I just mentioned before, the Mackhatcher Parkway and the roads that are essentially west of I-65. So this is daily changes in traffic as a result of the interchange being closed. And the next slide.
Can I ask a question? If you said you were going to have questions as we go.
Sure.
Where are those coming from? Are they coming from the other side of the interstate and then going there, or what?
I think a lot of them are. I think a lot of them are probably destined to areas around the interchange and along Lewisburg, but around the interchange. So they're choosing to use Carruthers Extended to eventually make their way to the area west of I-65.
Did you incorporate any development at all in your numbers?
Yeah, we took a look at the land use and we made an estimation of what we thought would be developed by 2015 that's new. And so that is plugged into the model, okay. Yes, sir.
Particularly the Berry Farms area and all
how
that.
Much of
Lead
that,
Park.
Yeah.
How much of that you predicted will be built by that time?
I'd have to go look
that's,
at that.
That's something that we ought to see.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Okay. Right, yeah.
That's something we need to see.
Sure, we can get that for you.
Any other questions about the slides?
So they would cross, could I ask, I'm sorry, they would cross there at Goose Creek and then go to the other side of the interstate to come up?
Yeah, I think it would be both. I think you would see that, and you would also see traffic that's on Murfreesboro that would just go on and use Carruthers Extended to get back down to Goose Creek.
When we discussed this, that was one of the things we talked about. As you can see, the number there at the interchange went from minus 5,500 to minus 6,300. And we use the assumption that if you've got all these people coming from the south, or I guess it could be either direction, but people that would be normally using the interstate that can't get to the interstate, some of them would likely choose to go across the interstate, go up South Carruthers rather than go up Lewisburg Pike or Columbia. That's part of what that change is.
Did you throw in your model at all the under or overpass at Ladd Lane?
Yeah, I believe that is in the model actually. But the land, well, like you said, whether or not it's under or over, we don't know yet. But yeah, that's in the model itself.
It is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So just to summarize, without Carruthers Extended, the traffic, if the interchange is closed, the traffic's going to probably use Murfreesboro and then make its way to Mack Hatcher, and then to the south on Lewisburg and Columbia Avenue. If Carruthers is extended, it's going to attract some traffic that would normally do that, but their destinations are probably still west of I-65, so they're going to end up, as we said, going down Carruthers extended, then making their way to the west to cross 65 at the interchange.
Well, if Carruthers were built and you're increasing the Busboro Road interchange or exit, if Carruthers was built, you're probably going to back up to a couple of the others to increase those, because I think people will get off as soon as they can get off on that thing. And
well, that's actually a good segue into the next slide.
Okay.
And this is an illustration that's very, very detailed, and I'll try to keep it as simple as possible because it's hard to comprehend in just a short period of time. But this is an illustration that shows the intersection operation under various conditions. And just to give you a quick summary, the bubbles represent an intersection. And then within the bubbles, there are other circles. The top circles are the morning peak, and the bottom circles are the afternoon peak. The two circles to the immediate left are existing 2010 conditions. The next set of bubbles over to the right are 2015 with no changes to the road network. And then the next set of bubbles to the right are 2015 with the interchange closed, and then the rightmost set of bubbles are 2015 with the interchange closed and Carruthers Parkway extended. So does that make sense, everybody? The bubbles, the top numbers, the top are AM, the bottom are PM, and the it's color-coded. Green means good, red means bad. Yellow is sort of in between, and this is I'm trying to stay away from our normal traffic engineering lingo and keep it, because, you know, we like to talk that way, but no one else does. But anyway, the green numbers represent a good level service. The red number is a bad level service. So you can see, and again, to orient you, this is Murfreesboro Road there, and this is I-65. And if you look at a quick glance, you can see the intersections that are red today and projected to be red in the future. For example, we talked about the, I think, let's see, this intersection here that I'm pointing at is the ramp terminal, the northbound ramps at Murfreesboro Road. The intersection right below that's this one. This one is Carruthers and Murfreesboro Road. This is Murfreesboro Road and Arno. And then moving up, you've got the other ramps. This is the southbound ramps. The next one up is Royal Oaks. And see, Royal Oaks was just improved recently. And see, in fact, we had this wrong to begin with. We had it the old way. And all these bubbles were red, indicating lots of problems. But the improvements have made a major difference in the congestion at Royal Oaks and Murfreesboro. So that's good. Look at this one is Lewisburg and Royal Oaks right here. So notice how there's a lot of red there.
Lewisburg and Royal Oaks.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry. Lewisburg and Mac Hatcher there. So lots of red, indicating lots of congestion and lots of delays. So that's kind of a quick glance at what we expect to happen. So let's see. I'm trying to see if I want to spend more time on this one or move on.
What are the numbers inside
the dates?
That's a good question. Those are actual delays that are being experienced today or projected in the future. So they correlate with the colors. They're gotcha. Based on the level service, and the definition of levels of service are in delays. So those are additional information that kind of backs up the colors.
Those are minutes or number of cars?
Those are seconds of delay, yeah.
I was out there again yesterday. Every time I come by, 96 and Mac Hatcher at between 5 and 6 o'clock in the afternoon, the cars are backed all the way up to there.
Yeah.
I mean, virtually every single time on a weekday,
yeah.
And it still shows yellow on there. I don't understand that.
Well, and that's a good point. These are average vehicular delays for the whole intersection. Now, there are some approaches that still could be worse than what we're showing here as the average.
Right.
And you may be in the approach that's the worst of all of them. So the improvements
turning
are...
Turning south, yeah.
Yeah.
south, down
yeah.
there,
and I think without dwelling on the numbers a lot, because we will give you all a handout afterwards so that you can take this away and read it and take a look at it more closely, but without dwelling on the numbers, here's the bottom line of this analysis. The traffic along Murfreesboro and Royal Oaks and Mac Hatcher is bad. You all experience that every day. It's even though you all have made improvements at the Royal Oaks and in Murfreesboro intersection, in general, those roads are congested. Lots of delays and lots of congestion. That's going to get worse in 2015 because of development. Development takes place, more traffic, more delays. And then if the I-65 and Goose Creek interchange is closed for construction, those bad intersections get worse. I mean, it's as simple as that. And so, and then I guess let's just go to the next slide and I'll sort of wrap this up. Here's what we're finding. That first bullet item is exactly what I said. If the Goose Creek interchange is, if it's closed, it's going to impact already congested intersections, mostly along Murfreesboro and Royal Oaks, and Matt Hatcher. If Goose Creek is extended to the south, that there's a 3,800 vehicle diversion. If I'm sorry, Carruthers is extended to the south, and there's a 3,800 vehicle diversion of traffic, mostly from those congested intersections. If it's here's the thing too. If Carruthers is extended to the south, then the intersection of Carruthers and Murfreesboro is going to have to be improved over what it is today. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to realize those gains in traffic. That's a bottleneck today. It gets worse in the future, and so it minimizes the impact of extending Carruthers if you don't make those improvements. So where we are in the study is looking at some options and thinking about what to do next, and that's what that last bullet item represents. I guess the big choice is as a city, do you support the idea of closing the interchange during construction? And I think that the TDOT would make the argument that if you close it, it'll be done faster and we can get it open faster. And hopefully there would be incentives to make that happen. But the traffic congestion worsens if you close the interchange. It has to, because it's accommodating traffic. It has to go somewhere. So if the interchange is closed during construction, then there really needs to be some improvements made to the surrounding road system to make up the difference in capacity and to accommodate those additional trips. And so it's a choice of, would you rather take the hit in a shorter period of time and have the interchange closed, or insist that it be left open and accommodate the traffic as best you can during the construction. And then some of the other bullet items kind of feed off that. One of the things I think needs to happen either way is getting information to the public about the interchange construction. If it's closed, you want to inform the public that the interchange is closed and here's some alternate routes. If it's open, you still want to do the same thing, because it's going to be more congested even if it stays open. Another thing I think is extremely important is a partnership with TDOT, and I think, and I can speak from some experience in Knoxville with the closure of I-40 and with the Smart Fix project. The city of Knoxville asked for and got some improvements made to the surrounding street system because of that closure, and these were permanent improvements that benefit the city even today. So that's something I think that you all should pursue.
Were they the new streets or existing?
Well, these were existing streets, but I think anything can be on the table.
Okay.
And I think it should be on the table.
Well, just as he mentioned a few minutes ago, Carruthers, Murfreesboro Road intersection improvements, getting that done prior to the closing, or other intersection improvements. And a lot of this really can be handled through intersection improvements versus necessary long lengths of improved roadway. Matt Hatcher, as we have one person in the room, Ms. Peterson, has pointed out forever, in that general area, Matt Hatcher is going to require lanes on a lot of, so we can do some intersection improvements such as at Matt Hatcher and Lewisburg Pike, which will help. It will help it. But ultimately, take care of probably would be a widening of Matt Hatcher. But we have three signalized intersections that are definitely affected in this study on Matt Hatcher, and that being Lewisburg, Royal Oaks, and 96. Some improvements in all three of those intersections, modifications prior to, could probably help us as far as the mitigation of this of the effects that we're going to have. It will not. I don't want to lead anybody to believe that it'll take care of the problem, because without widening, I don't think we could ever do that. So, but there's other issues or other things we can do that that will help minimize it.
Well, the reality is also that whether or not they leave the interchange open or closed, the construction is going to have an impact on traffic in the city of Franklin, because there are going to be temporary lane closures while they're doing construction, you know. So I think it's very important to point out to work with TDOT in either situation and try to get, whether they leave it open or closed or whatever, it's going to be an impact. So try to work with TDOT and get some things done, some spot improvements that'll help regardless.
Yeah, and the spot improvements would be done such that they would fit into the future if you're doing the widening. It would be done in such a way that it fit into that future improvement that would need to be done. It wouldn't be just go out there and do something and then dig it up later. You'd do it in such a manner that it could be incorporated into the future ultimate section that you'd build.
Could I ask a question? Do you think that that part that they're talking about bidding or letting in September, when do you think that might be done? Sure.
You know, Ms. Peterson, I didn't even think to ask that when I was on the phone. I know he told me that they were told to focus on getting that part designed so they could get it under construction left by September. And quite honestly, I didn't even think to ask him when he thought it might be done, but I would guess it's going to be a couple of years, wouldn't you, David?
I was thinking they were saying 14 to 18 months, but I don't remember for sure. We had some number at one point.
From the time it's
starts.
Construction started?
Starts.
Mm-hmm. You're not looking for any kind of a motion and decision?
No, we just, this came up in previous meeting that yes, we've had this ongoing study, and it was said we need to bring something to you. And that's what this is, just to try to bring something up to you.
And there's a handout for taking home?
Yes, sir.
All right. Well, unless there's anything else?
And I think, well, I did want to say, too, that we printed these two to a page. If you all want it onto a page, just let David know, and I can get it for you.
Okay. Thank you.
We can email it to you.
Okay.
How about you just print it too, though? I don't want to print all that black stuff off of mine.
In your plans, in your report, you said you had considered future development. It would be well to consider all the development possible, and then if we didn't have that development, it would just be that much nicer.
Yeah.
And easier.
Yeah, that's basically what the long-range plan does. It just tries to set it up in some sort of estimated time frame of when certain things
give us the worst scenario, and then if it doesn't happen, that's great.
But then again, think about this is only a temporary solution, because hopefully all of the state work is going to be done. I mean, the intersection is going to be completed and operational, and the interstate itself is going to be widened much before that final development is
right.
You know, the development part of it is done.
But
that's a great thing that it's going ahead and being done by the state right now, kind of in front of the development.
Well, that's a good point, and to your point, is that, you know, this study obviously is focused on the construction time period and when things are going to be under construction and how that's going to impact the area. So what we did was try to project out how the scenario for 2015 in terms of growth. Now the major thoroughfare plan that we've also talked about and worked on, it actually projects out to 2030, or 2035, I'm sorry. So that's the one where it's going to identify your longer term, more permanent, you know, big ticket items as far as improvements go. So that will certainly address.
But you're going to get us through this.
We're trying to get this 2015 to figure out what needs to be done in the short term to try to make things, as David said, there's not something we're going to be able to do that's just going to make the situation great, but at least make it a little better if possible.
Okay. Thank you. Number four, consideration of the ownership and maintenance agreement for decorative sign frames and posts for traffic control signs on Spencer Creek Road and Hillstone Farms HOA. This is pretty simple, isn't it?
Move approval.
Did you read it? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Number five is a change order, consideration of requested change order number two for the Columbia Avenue Phase One project of a segment one of the Franklin Corridor and Connector Streets Economic Development Project for a contract time extension of 26 calendar days.
This is one of the handouts I did before the meeting, and I apologize for that. I actually had it on my computer the other day when Lene was putting the packet together and failed to realize it and did not get it.
Cost nothing, they just need a little time.
Just add 26 days, motion to approve.
Second.
Recommend approval.
Aye. Number six, consideration of the professional services agreement with CDM for the development of a drought management plan in an amount not to exceed $38,000.
This, I'm going to let Mark explain majority. It is something that we are required to do by TDEC as far as getting a drought management plan in conjunction with any other plan we have.
Mr. Hilty, how long do you think this one will take?
The initial deadline was the beginning of October.
I mean, how long will this item take to discuss?
This item, I could do it very quickly.
Well, here's why. There are people here on another item, and I'm going to have to leave probably before the end of the meeting, but the item that people are here on is one that I have an interest in.
I can give you a really quick summary, and if you need more information, we can pump it a little later. Okay. Drought management plan was a result of the 2007-2008 droughts that we had. TDEC, of course, is requiring this of us, and I believe it's over 100 other municipalities or utility districts across Tennessee. We had initially started to do the work in-house, and we have run into resource problems, just the time to get this work done. What this does is drills down into some detailed trigger points on how we operate and manage the system during times of drought. It goes through agreements with neighboring utility districts, coordination with TDEC and the other utility districts to ensure that we can support each other when all or some of us have troubles in the future. We've started taking measures already in certain areas throughout the system with other utility districts, but this is a requirement that formalizes that process when we do have extended droughts as we did in 2007-2008. So I would request that we move forward to get this
contract. This agreement will be on your standard professional services agreement with the cost and using the proposal as the scope of services.
Okay. Is there a motion?
So move.
Second. All in favor say aye.
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 Number seven. Review and discussion concerning the planned improvements for the Carlisle Lane and signal design at Highway 96 West project. Just by way of introduction, you may remember that we are making improvements to Carlisle Lane and Highway 96. We have had a meeting at which some of the homeowners from Carlisle had come in and the HOA and asked us to maybe look at a couple of different options. As I understand it, all interested stakeholders in the area and the city staff now have an agreement on at least the alignment of the, am I mistaken?
I don't know if there's an agreement. I mean,
the stakeholders in the area have recommended a certain alignment. Staff is still, if I'm correct, is still recommending the original line. And that is because of the cost difference.
Do you know?
There's a cost difference between the one alignment and another?
Yes.
Well, just for the fact that we'd have to go back and redesign.
It's design cost.
Yes.
Not construction cost.
$100,000
for the retaining wall.
Well, there's other options.
The alignment is one thing. Yes. The alignment is one thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's three issues.
Aesthetic.
Yes.
The alignment, does the alignment cost anything more?
Yes. Because of design.
Additional design.
How much?
Construction-wise, I don't believe so. But as far as design-wise, I believe we had $15,500.
Right, and the project cost is estimated to be?
$2 million.
So that $15,000 worth of design cost to do it the way the neighbors, including the HOA and the historic property owner, would rather it be done.
Staff's only reason for recommending the original alignment is additional cost.
And do we know what that is?
$15,000.
$15,000.
$15,000 more.
Right, on a $2 million project.
Would they be willing to pay that?
Would they?
Would the homeowners be willing to paint that?
I doubt it. They haven't said so. They haven't stated that.
Well, have we asked them?
No, they've only done it. The only thing they've done is asked for these additional improvements. So I don't know.
I just think we need to be careful about adding a lot to it. If we've already got it done and planned and they want something else, you know, I would think maybe they would be willing to.
A board that approved $2 million worth of cosmetic improvements on Columbia Avenue should not bat an eye at $15,000 on a $2 million project. My humble opinion.
Is there, from an engineering standpoint, are there any downsides to option three?
No.
Eliminating that you have to go design it more, which is $15,000.
Yeah, would there be any taking that out? Every single option that's been presented will work from an engineering standpoint. Nothing was eliminated from an engineering standpoint. When we came up with the original design, all the factors that we used, cost and safety and everything else, all of them
won't be violating any design standards.
No, but I mean,
by the way, $15,000 divided by $2 million is 0.0075.
I hear staff. The only thing he was concerned about was the money. They brought it to us, and now it's for us to decide.
Now it's up for us to decide.
So if you want to spend $15,000 more on design, and there's not a reason otherwise.
Here's the difference. Okay, the difference is how close Carlisle runs to the homes in the Carlisle subdivision. And the redesign is to shift the center of the road away from 12 or 15 homes, maybe more. I'm guessing the Carlisle HOA people here, if I get this wrong, they'll let me know. There's at least 12 or 15 homes probably that back directly up to this. And the road shift would be how many feet?
Well, where the houses are the closest to Carlisle, either option does not change, because by the time you get to where the houses are the closest, it's back to the same alignment. The only difference is closer down to the intersection, and that's part of that was part of staff's original thinking. It's open space. It's not close to the houses. If you do shift it, it gets farther away from those houses down there, but the houses that are the closest do not receive any relief.
Well, that's because we're not realigning the length of Carlisle. We're doing an intersection improvement.
Right. But even when this gets extended further,
I understand, but that, well, let's put it this way. The people that own those houses and that represent the people that own those houses feel like this is worth doing. They've made this request. Mm-hmm. Now, they consider it better. If I live there, I might feel the same way. Mr. Skinner.
How many feet to the west does this redesign of the roadway an option for? How many feet does it cost?
I think it's about 20 feet. 20 to 30 feet at the intersection.
At max. Now keep in mind that it is a varying as you go north, but at max. And what it does is it will require us, and my understanding again, it will require us to obtain some right-of-way or easements off of the historic property.
Right-of-way and easement.
So what is he saying?
He's agreeing. Mr. Ford, who owns that, he is making a recommendation in conjunction with the homeowners association that he does not have a problem with that change.
And he's going to let you have the right-of-way for nothing?
Without
he said that
has not been said, but it's not
$15,000.
How much right away are we talking here?
It's roughly a wash.
Yeah,
that's why I said the biggest difference is now if we change, we're now adding 15 more.
Well, you're buying right away on one side or the other.
Right.
There's not more right away. It's where it is.
It's roughly the same.
Totally.
Now, one thing I will say though, and this is coming from an appraiser, not from me that doesn't know costs for appraisals, but from the appraisal standpoint, that property is going to be worth more than open space that's
28 feet away.
Right. So there may be, I mean, and we haven't done an appraisal to know this, but there may be an additional cost. No, it's not a bunch of right-of-ways, so I'm not, you know, it may be another little bit.
Again, we don't know that cost, but the cost itself is going to...
We don't know the cost.
Overall project cost is going to be...
No, we know the cost of the original, because we've already, I mean, that's what got us to this point. We were negotiating for easements and right-of-ways.
But it's really going to be a minimum difference.
It's $100,000 for the new retaining wall, only an option two. It's not an option...
What you're talking about, what you've discussed up to now is just strictly looking at alignment. There's two other issues, that's landscaping and the wall that you need to discuss.
Right, the first, well, and if we don't do the, I don't know, if we don't realign, then some of these other things may be different too. I mean, are they still...
Well, I mean, landscaping, there's no design on landscaping. So, I mean, if we want, if y'all chose to do some landscaping, if you chose to do the decorative wall like they've asked for, things like that, then that could be done with any alignment chosen.
That's additional cost.
That's an add-on regardless of the option.
Either option is an add-on.
Okay, but it's not impossible if we don't pick option three.
No, you can...
You can do it under any circumstances.
Yes, yeah. And likely, we would be getting into or close to the landscaping with that original alignment. And I would recommend in that case that if we did get into any, or if we needed to do additional screening, that would be appropriate there.
It doesn't sound like it's a huge deal to go to option three, which is what the neighbors and the...
Because do we have this funded?
Yeah, delays.
You don't have construction funded.
We don't have construction funded.
Yeah. No. This is high on your priority list, but it's out of the funding range right now.
So if the design, a redesign or different design will not delay start?
Unless you chose to fund it with the upcoming CIP process that we're doing here soon.
Well, yeah, but that still won't delay.
I thought you said it would delay.
Huh?
If we move forward with the existing
alignment as proposed,
it would construction plans would be completed quicker than if we went back, redesigned, and changed alignment.
To three.
Any delay right now is concerning getting construction plans complete. As far as what we're talking about otherwise, as far as the delay actually going into construction, due to the funding, due to the way prioritizations have been done, we do not foresee a delay in any construction. There will be a delay in actually getting the plans if you go to option three.
But you haven't funded the project yet anyway, so it's not necessarily in the big picture a project delay.
Right.
So we're discussing here, right?
Well,
we need to give you some direction.
Well, we need direction on realignment. Do we want to go to option three and go on and start the design for that? Then we'll need a decision concerning, do we want to add landscaping to the project, regardless of which option you look at. And then the third decision is, do you want to add the retaining wall or the decorative wall to the project, which would be, again, adding for either option. So there's really three things that we're needing to ask you for. It sounds, well, just kind of going forward, sounds like this committee right now does not have a problem with going with the realignment. As a consensus, without a vote right now. Yeah. So.
The chair typically does not make motions, but if the chair did, it would be very clearly to recommend option three.
Then I would make the motion for option three on the $15,000 realignment.
All right, we've talked about that a little bit. All in favor of that, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, now we have...
Landscaping.
Landscaping.
Let's look at this landscaping. Do you want to add landscaping to the design? Beyond what's landscaped out there existing right now, basically.
Is this not a precedent?
We have done landscaping in some of our major projects, yes.
I could swear I've seen sprinklers going in on Columbia Avenue for the last 18 months.
But there's other projects that do not have landscaping.
Okay, well, there's some, that's true. But
so it's...
But let's don't act like we haven't bought a bunch of flowers on 3rd Avenue.
But we've also heard from you that you have issues with that, so we're trying to minimize.
And look, I'll be as cynical as you can imagine. Here's the deal: when it's my people, I want it. Okay, so they want the landscaping. It's not that much money. I'm for it.
See,
And by the way, here's the real touchstone for me. We're only talking about this because we're doing a traffic improvement. Okay? That's where I fell off the wagon with Columbia Avenue. We're not doing anything about traffic there, but let's don't rehash that. We're just prettifying. Okay? This is an actual infrastructure improvement that we can do a few things nice while we're doing it. That's the difference. And that's what the people who live there would like to see us do. Right now they have a beautifully landscaped area with a natural rock wall buffer off of 96. That's what they have.
Yeah.
And when we go and do this, we're going to plow through that, and they're going to be left with a grass slope, no natural rock wall buffer on the corner there, and they'd like to see something to mitigate that new exposure to noise and traffic. That's what they're asking for.
Well, these are my people too, at large.
That's right.
So I would move that we will look at adding a landscape.
How much landscaping is it?
I think what we'd do there is we would tell the consultant to, you know, come up with some sort of design that he would think would be appropriate based on landscaping a roadway. And I'm sure he'd have a landscape architect be looking at this. So, I mean, we can do that.
And, I mean, this would be one time, put it in, and then it's up to them to maintain. We're not talking about undertaking to maintain.
We're talking about basically
when we restore, because there's going to be a construction easement. There's going to be some permanent right-of-way taken. I assume a construction easement. And we're talking about when we restore and leave.
If we design and install landscaping in the right-of-way itself, then the question of maintenance is sort of fuzzy.
Okay, well, it doesn't necessarily have to be in the right-of-way. It could be on the common.
It would not be in the right-of-way because unless y'all chose to do trees or something inside the right-of-way.
No,
landscaping they're talking about.
We're talking about as we leave the project and put down the seed or the straw or the
right.
or the mulch or the what do you call it?
We'll replace the fence. To do it all the time.
Turf. Sod. Doing something more than just the bare bones TDOT, throw the seed and throw down some straw and be on your way. Now, as I understand it, what they're asking for is something that we leave in their common area, and it's their responsibility, so it's basically purchasing landscaping items one time. Which, I mean, again, we've done more than that elsewhere.
I made a motion.
You made a motion?
Yeah.
Okay. Second.
All right. All in favor of that, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Dave, there's a retaining wall.
Retaining wall being the last thing.
Okay, now this is a $100,000 item.
Talk a little bit about that. I mean, it's replacing one?
No.
It's adding one.
If you go down 96, when you get out that direction, it's one of these things you drive by and you don't really probably notice it until someone asks you to notice it. Right now, off the shoulder and a little up the hill, there's kind of a rock outcropping. And when we do this project, we're going to kind of lay that out. We're going to flatten all that stuff out. And there's a plan for a multi-purpose walkway, more than a sidewalk and less than a
pedestrian bike lane.
It's a pedestrian bike lane, okay? And I gather it's off of the roadway.
Yes, it's separate from the road. It's just like what we did on Carruthers Parkway.
All right, so it's not part of the road. It's not inside the curbs. Mm-hmm. It's off the curb in a way.
Separate.
All right. And so one plan has that close to the road, and the HOA is asking that it kind of move a little further from the road. Is that correct? They're asking that it move a little further from the road and that there be a retaining wall placed next to it, which would kind of replicate the rock outcropping that's going to be taken down during the construction process. Did I describe that correctly?
I don't think they're sold on that it has to be moved further away. I think they were open to either our typical grass strip of 5 or 6 feet, and then the multi-use path or snaking it over further away from the road.
Okay. But the request is for the, is for a retaining wall to kind of replicate the loss of the rock outcropping. And I gather that that's sort of a sound barrier, privacy mitigation type issue. Have I got that right?
Somewhat. I think, I mean, if we slope it, it's still gonna have some, but I think that's their concern. They want to have some solid
north. Now, what would the length of such a retaining wall be? I mean, we're not talking about the one at, like at Fieldstone where it's 20 feet tall.
No.
We're talking about waist or shoulder.
Yeah, height-wise, it probably, I mean, it wouldn't be much high, it wouldn't be any higher than what you've got out there right now.
The rock.
With the rock. Right.
So,
five to eight feet, whatever.
We're talking something like Del Rio, which down
what a graveyard. Not quite that high. Not quite that. I think that's a little bit higher. I think that's a little higher.
What a graveyard.
And what length?
I'm not sure exactly how long it would have to go down through.
That would be a design, as you're doing the design, determining that length to actually.
Should we have it?
Now, and this part of the project has not been designed.
Yes.
It has?
Well, not a wall, no.
Okay.
This along 96 does not really change, even with the alignment change. This is pretty much done. What we did is a typical.
It's one of those concrete press rock simulation.
Yeah. I mean, right now we've got a typical 3-to-1 slope that
just
comes
grassed.
Off. Yes.
If we do a wall, we will not recommend just a concrete wall. It'll be a form liner or actually a stack of veneer or something like that. We will not do we don't do that in Franklin anymore.
Well, the difference in cost for that is very minimal because it's just a form and they've got those standard now. So that's whether it's a deck.
Cost is doing it at all.
Right.
Yeah. Whether you do it or
not. Yes.
Well, we can get it past this committee. I mean, I think. If there's additional discussion.
We can also
I would be against a $100,000 wall. I don't think that rock that's sticking out there takes the place of a wall. I mean, I don't think a wall would, I mean, that's just there because it was there when they dug it. And those people knew when they bought those houses that was a right-of-way through there, that there was going to be an improved intersection. And I don't think we need to spend $100,000 on a wall at that just because it's an intersection and just because the rock's going to be removed.
I'll support the neighborhood's request, but on this one I realize that reasonable people can disagree because of the six-figure tag.
I will make the motion that we acknowledge their request but move on to the full board.
Okay. Without a recommendation for or against.
I'll go the non-recommendation route.
Okay. Have it considered by the full board.
Yes.
Okay. All in favor of that?
Aye.
Okay. Is that item?
If so.
Mr. Barnhill.
Yo.
Would you kindly
yes, run I will.
To this? I have a prior engagement. Thank you.
Item 8, consideration of the professional services agreement, City of Franklin contract 2010-0120 with RPM Transportation Consultants LLC for the single design at the intersection of Nickel Mill Lane and Mowry Lane in the lump sum fee of $27,000. Mr. Parker.
As you'll recall, this project has been approved during your small project prioritization, and we did indicate to you we had some additional signal work that had to be done. That's what this is, and we would be entering into a separate professional services agreement, which is your standard agreement, and the $27,000 is the lump sum cost for the work that is being proposed.
Entertain a motion up or down to recommend that to the full board.
So moved, yes.
Okay.
Yes, moved.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
So it is the committee's recommendation to recommend to the board to accept the $27,000 contract.
Yes.
Number 9, consideration of change order number 1 for the ARRA Clean Water Project, Country Road Low Pressure Sewer, Boyd Mill Low Pressure Sewer, and Simmons Ridge Sanitary Sewer Projects with W.L. Haley and Company in the amount of, is that $19,670? Total construction amount for this change order is $1,203,144. Mr. Parker.
This is, for the most part, to add some steel casing for the Simmons Ridge Interceptor Sewer, where we need to get it going and get it cased before we build the road itself. And it would get it out from under wing walls for culvert. And that's the majority of the cost now, or maybe all the cost. Yeah. It is all the cost. I'm sorry. Okay. Yes. Yes, it's on the Simmons Ridge portion of the project. But it's to make sure that the sewer line itself is taken care, will be taken care of, will not have to be worked on when the road comes through.
So we go from what to 70 feet?
50. It's a total of 70 feet, 55 on one side and 15 on the other.
Okay.
Basically, of the alignment of the road.
When the sewer was designed, we knew that there would be some casing done. We didn't have the full alignment, the full design of South Carruthers at that time. Now that we've got it, we know exactly where that box culvert's going to be, and just had to extend it a little bit.
Move approval.
Proper motion to a second.
Second, and I'm going to just ask something. Will that mean that if we go on and approve this, that this can be put in before the road is put down, so as soon as the road's put down, we don't have to dig it up?
Correct. Right.
Like we do everything else.
Good idea.
All the time.
We'll try to do that. No.
Proper motion to second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Item 10, consideration of change order number one for the Southeast Corridor Water System Improvement and Water Booster Station Project with Century Construction for a time extension of the contract. Number 10.
There is no set amount that we're trying to do at this point because, as you recall, we ran into some problems getting the design of the booster station. And then, therefore, as far as delivery dates for the booster station itself. So once we have all that settled, we're going to stop the contract with this contractor for that right now. Once all that is settled and we have the delivery times and dates, then we will know when we can start back up, and we'd be looking at 120 days from that date of when we start back to complete the project. And that at that time we'll know when it's all finished. But right now we're going to stop the project. Want to stop the project? Will be no time running. Will be no payments or anything. And then we'll restart the project when we have all that finalized. And it'll be 120 days from that point.
Second. And I have. If approved, the contractor shall cease work until the city receives approved pump station plans and a firm date for the pump delivery.
Right. That's what I was talking
about. So, are we...
The pump manufacturer hasn't provided a date to that.
There is a date estimated October to November, but there was a delay in getting order of the pumps until we had a better idea of to make sure of what the booster station itself was going to be. It's been sort of a complicated issue.
There's the design and there's the responsiveness of the pump manufacturer,
right.
Is my understanding.
Right.
Both of those are issues outside of this contractor's control. We're trying to get those resolved.
We're going to get those resolved, but we do not want to penalize the contractor, of course, because it's not his fault.
So there's only one pump manufacturer?
Yes.
This is a specific contract.
For that specific problem?
Yes.
Proper motion and a second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Item 11, consideration of change order number one for the ARRA drinking water project, wastewater treatment plant, raw water reservoir rehabilitation, water treatment plant, rehabilitation project with Summit Constructors for a time extension of the contract. Mr. Parker, you up again.
This is recommended at 14-day extension based on the flooding and then delays there, plus there being an additional amount of sludge that had to be hauled off and disposed of correctly. It took some time to make sure we had all that taken care of. They're asking for 14 days. They're not close to finishing out the project as far as construction time. excuse me, but they are doing, as we have, as we say in contracts, as soon as they know what a delay is, they're asking for that, that time. So that's where we are. It would be a 14-day. We're really not sure that they're even going to need it, but that's what they're supposed to do by contract, so that's what we're...
Might they need more?
We don't think they're even going to need this.
Unless something else happens.
But as we say, as soon as you know, you have 10 days to let us know and ask for it. So that's what they're doing. They're following the contract.
Second.
Proper motion is second. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Sometime or other, I wouldn't mind seeing that.
Please call me.
So call me when you think of it.
Yeah.
Field trip, you're in separate.
Field trip.
Yeah. What's their percentage of flying?
Anyone else interested?
Yes.
I just extend that.
I would love to. Yeah, whoever wants to go, just please.
I drove Twitches the other day.
Luckily, it's a little cooler.
Wait till it's cooler, it'll be done.
We won't set anything on fire.
Actually, I prefer to see it before it is finished.
Yes, sir. As of August 8th, it was about 40% complete, so they're moving right along.
It looked good. I saw it maybe last week.
Do you,
right before they
want us to try to set up a time to go out, and anybody interested can do it?
Yes.
I'll be happy to do so.
Okay.
And ask Ann. I can go anytime. Pretty much anytime.
Can you go?
On a cool afternoon.
Yeah.
A cool morning.
We're going to get you close to the rim. You don't have to walk too far.
You can hold the next morning when you get
there. Let's do it.
Okay.
Like I said, I want to see it before you put water in it.
So what time is that? When is that? Before you put water in, what time that day?
Well, on completion of the project, we have to, of course, follow our permit for withdrawal, and hopefully at the end of construction, we'll start soon thereafter, start seeing the rain again. September generally is one of the driest months in Tennessee, in Middle Tennessee, so we look to October for when we start.
Before we start pumping out the river again.
We'll hopefully have
next night. You said you could pump 7 million gallons out of the river.
About 7 million, yes, sir.
If you had it to pump.
Right. Correct. Yes, sir. We physically can pump a little over 7 a day.
Item 12, street project status report. Dave, why don't you just go down through A through J, and if there's anything...
I'm actually going to have to let others address this. They're on it.
Go through A through J and we'll just...
Gantt charts for the street projects, I think, in your packet.
Yeah, that's great. Uh-huh, I have that.
So, Paul or whoever, as far as...
I guess start with my catcher. Start with my catcher. Continue to meet with property owners. Ben's done that the last several weeks. Made a lot of progress, and kind of hard to give you an update on that because he's making offers every day, so... I know he met with one property owner.
One or two
today. Just one today. So it's going well.
That's pretty much what's going on.
Hillsboro, not much change on that.
Well, I can address that a little bit. We have received back the contract from TDOT. If you'll recall, the board approved the contract contingent upon Mr. Stuckey, myself, and the city law office department approving the language. We had some concerns with the language. We have sent it back. We've got it back today. I think we're at the point where we're ready to get that contract signed. This is the additional contract. We do have the contract already in place for the spot improvements. This is for the additional work. So once we get that, then we can go with a submittal to TDOT on the plans themselves for their review to give us authorization to do right-of-way acquisition. So that's kind of where we are. And as you'll recall from an email from Mr. Stuckey, we are looking at some of the properties that were flooded as trying to do some acquisition of properties. The particular piece that we're talking about, we were not going to have to get right away. We were looking at it, if you recall, again, last July, the board decided we wanted to see if we could just acquire that piece of property. So that's where we are right now. So we will have an appraiser working on getting the appraisal on that property Monday. He'll start Monday, so we'll be looking at that. We're getting an appraisal on the one across the road already, too, that was damaged, that he's asked us to purchase.
Okay.
The property owner's asked us to purchase, I'm sorry.
Is that all, Hillsborough?
That's all I got, unless there's any questions.
No.
McEwen Phase 3, we've made some pretty good progress since the last update. We received the right-of-way certification from TDOT, submitted construction plans. Of course, when we submitted those, TDOT has a checklist that we've got to go through, and which includes Title VI compliance and coming up with a DBE goal, disadvantaged business goal, utility sign-off. We had a utility coordination meeting two days ago, and trying to work through their checklist, and we're still expecting. I think the last time we said it'd roughly be a month to get through the review process with TDOT, and we're still hoping that's the case.
And you're fixing to spend almost $1 million, $900,000 to Middle Tennessee Electric for relocations. We will be getting to Mr. Truel's office Monday, that request for check, hopefully get it cut Monday and get it to Middle Tennessee, and that will clear us as far as the agreement we have with Middle Tennessee concerning the relocation. There is the concern of, or there is the question of, can they just kill the line during construction and just go and take the poles? The poles are in our right of way. We cannot do much grading with the poles as they are now. So there may be some temporary relocations that will need to be done. I was thinking we had already paid for that, but I'll check on it. I just found out there's today that there was a question concerning that. So there may be additional for a real quick temporary fix, but we'll check on that and see. But again, and Mr. Truel's in the audience, so Mr. Truel, we will be asking for a $900,000 check from you Monday.
The board had previously approved that.
That is approved.
You already
approved that. If you recall, the original cost was going to be 1.5 something million, and then we reduced how much relocation is going to be. So we got that change back in the winter, I think, like February or something like that.
Third Avenue Extension.
Submitted plans to TDOT today, and hoping to hear back from them, kind of same timeline, hoping about a month to hear back from them, and be able to move forward with construction on that. South Carruthers, nothing's really changed on it. We're basically at the point where, until it's funded, we're not going to see much more progress on it.
Let me ask you this. We've got South Carruthers, and we've got impact fees on Lead Park, and we've got impact fees on, what is it, Nickel Mill? Nickel?
What? Nickel's Bend.
No fees have been paid on
those. No fees have been paid on those.
They haven't started anything.
But they are there. I mean, once they start the construction, road, whatever, so what other road do we have that we're trying to build that we're going to get the benefits, if there is such a thing as a benefit, and some aldermen might disagree with that, of road impact fees or the amount that we're going to get, such as South? Well, you've got 3,000 homes out South Carruthers that we're looking at some point in time. Where else is there a road that's going to generate that? The amount of road impact fees or the number of homes is going to contribute to that road. Is there one? You understand what I'm saying?
I think I do. I'm not sure that I know for sure if there is or not. Of course, the West Haven generates a lot. Any large subdivision would generate a lot. But
McKaysville, you're still building out?
They still have a little bit left. But keep in mind that impact fees right now can only be spent on an RTO roadway, and they can be spent anywhere in the city. So when we get them in, if we have a project going, they're basically spent on that for, because Russ doesn't
want to have.
And they also say that the road impact fees, as I understand it, just to pay the principal and interest, the debt service,
is going to be more than the amount of money projected that we have coming in this year. So in other words, just to pay for the debt service, every penny of the road impact fee that we're expecting, projecting for this year, and more is going to be needed just to pay the debt service.
I don't disagree with that, but if you don't have it, you got to go someplace else to get it.
Well, the other thing is, you can say, where is all those impact fees and all those other things that he talked about, West Haven and McKay's Mill and all of them, where have they gone? I mean, West Haven, have we improved anything out there for all the road impact fees we've gotten from them?
Well, if what Dave is saying is that it can go for any project, then I would say that, yes, it's gone to improve road projects.
Carruthers Parkway.
It went to Carruthers.
Yeah, it's Carruthers Parkway has used some of it. And keep in mind that you also have road impact fee offset agreements out there that have to be paid back. Yep. I think West Haven actually has two, maybe three of those. And that's from where they did work on 96 with turn lanes and signalization and things. Nichols Bend is actually committed by agreement to dedicate the right-of-way with no offset for that right-of-way across their property. That was the agreement that we entered into them with them a year and a half or whatever it was ago. So they're committed to dedicate that right-of-way with no offset.
And I forget what the answer is every time I ask, because I ask about every 2 months or so. West Haven committed at one time $1 million or whatever it was in order to get their...
West Haven has committed $1.25 million, excuse me, towards Mack Hatcher extension. We have not received payment for that at this point. They have also got committed $200,000, I believe it is, for the intersection of Hillsborough Road, 5th Avenue, and 96 West. We have not received any payment on that as of yet either.
So that's you asked for it?
We haven't built it yet, either.
We have asked for the $1.25 million payment based on the fact that we have design completed, and they, I think they asked for an extension or something for payment of that. I can't remember us. But that's where we are, and it's still sitting out there, basically sitting out there in the bank to come into us. I guess what.
But then I don't remember us buying the building to start. They came up and offered the $1 million, $1.2 million, or whatever it was, in order to have the restrictions taken off of the number of houses that were to be built, and whatever the other one was. I don't know what it was. We'd have the wastewater treatment plant expansion completed, and there had to be X number of houses
in district
or whatever on it.
Yeah, I don't remember.
But anyway, I just, you know, I ask it about every 2 months, and I can't remember what the answer is. 2 months later. Go ahead.
Are we going to allow or give a permit to the new developments that are planned for South Carruthers Parkway before this extension is done?
There are no restrictions on it, as I recall.
They've already been approved?
That's right.
Their concept is approved. I'm not sure they've got any site plans approved.
So they can go on and put those hundreds and hundreds of houses out there with that little road.
But I think that probably would be a wise decision.
Didn't we approve the one that's over there on Lewisboro?
Yeah.
The part of it over on Lewisboro?
Stream Valley? Stream Valley?
On South Carolina.
No. The part of the bar property.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, no, that's been approved.
Well, I'm not talking about those. I'm talking about the ones on
Nichols Bend or what?
No, I'm talking about the ones down.
Nichols Bend and Last Park.
I'm not talking about those.
Last Park's already approved.
I'm talking about.
Simmons Ridge.
Yes, thank you.
Old South Carruthers. Right now in the mill is Nichols Bend, Simmons Ridge, and Ladd Park. Ladd Park, of course, has multiple sections that have been approved, and it was not contingent on anything as far as Carruthers, other than at one point they were, when they got to that point, they would have to build Carruthers across their property. That is being changed as we worked out the agreement with Ladd Park for extension.
What about
Simmons Ridge, I believe, have had in the past a concept plan approved, but they do not have
with the concept plan.
They're coming back with a revised concept. There is no site plans have been approved for it, so there is nothing to, for construction to start. Nickel Bend, again, has a concept plan approved, but I don't think they have any section of the site plan approved yet. They are actually looking at trying to, in what they're discussing with us, they're looking at trying to start their project back up in the near future, as far as going forward with plan revision.
Would we even consider those with no improvement to South Carruthers?
Well, we have to review the plans, et cetera, and then staff would make recommendations concerning what could or should, or recommendations of what could be done.
And they're donating right away. And so, you know, it kind of goes hand in hand with that whole process. I mean, in order to get developed, you've got to donate the right of way. In order to get the right of way, it's got to be developed. And then there's permit fees and road access fees that goes once it gets developed, which will pay that back off. So it kind of has to be done simultaneous. But it's not up to them to get the city to build the road. It's up to the city to build the road.
I understand that. But if the city can't build the road right now.
Well, but then you're going to tell a developer who's already got a site plan approved and has already bought the land and concept plan approved, I'm sorry, you can't develop your product because the city doesn't have any money.
Then maybe we ought not to.
Well, it's already been approved, though. It's already been approved.
Why would we do that? Why would we do that?
We do it all the time.
Why? I don't care that we do it all the time.
Because otherwise we would never have anything approved. We wouldn't approve a single thing because there's never the money that's in the bank ready to do a project. I mean, we wouldn't have the mall. We wouldn't have anything at Cool Spring. Because
they built those roads.
That's exactly right.
In the mall. They built them.
Mm-hmm. But not all of them, some of them.
No. We built that last little piece. But no.
Well, we built Mallory Lane.
Keep in mind, typically, the existing roads can handle a certain amount of increase. So what has happened in the past, as Clyde was mentioning with West Haven, they could do up to a point that a study showed that, you know, that could be handled with what was there.
Which is the way South Carruthers is. Nichols Bend has been approved with the current South Carruthers development, South Carruthers Road. And there's access on the South Carruthers.
Right.
And it was approved to handle that until that road access, and so was Ladd Park. Exactly how it was approved.
You have some access now.
Right.
Handles a certain level of Correct. Startup of the development.
Yeah. And so
that'll dictate how they build. I mean, they've only got two access, maybe one access on the existing South Carruthers, so they can only do so much until the road's done.
So that, in theory, they're going to get so many COs.
Yeah.
All right. Columbia Avenue Streetscape Project.
It's called, well,
date.
It's, well, now that
according
we
to this.
Now, well, it depends on if this change order gets approved or not. I don't remember what that's going to add to it, but it's going to be sometime next month.
Okay.
And it's going well. If you've driven by in the last couple of weeks.
Tried to.
Yes.
The light that's going to come off 9th and Curly Q there to church. Is that going to be on in sync?
Yes. It'll be just like
that. I have a little backup.
Down at Granbury.
Not that far down.
It'll be like how you got the offset signals there. They'll work in unison.
There. There was people in the way. Couldn't come out because people blocked the intersection.
Those intersections that are offset like that, they present problems, but you can sync those signals together.
And we've covered Carlisle Lane, Boyd Mill, I think.
You don't want to cover it anymore?
No.
Phase 3 of the software, phase 3 of the infrastructure, and Franklin ITS.
On the top projects, on the ITS project.
Is that what you called it?
Yeah. ITS.
It's going well. It's getting ready to start.
It's getting ready to start.
Yeah, we had the pre-construction meeting, I guess about 2 weeks ago, and issued notice to proceed. This is a little bit different project. You know, they've got it's conduit and fiber and everything, so they've got a lot of materials to order on the front end, not a whole lot of actual excavation. So you won't actually see them working for probably another month or so. But we've issued the notice to proceed, and that'll be a big improvement for our transportation center. And I guess the last one, Cool Springs, the traffic signals, survey is complete on that, and they're just getting started on design. So probably CIP meeting or CIC meeting, we'll at least have seen preliminary plans and have some maybe a little bit more to report on that.
One thing we do not have on this list, Mallory Station, General George Patton, Duke Drive signalization. We have cut the check and sent it to CSX with the contract that we had to do. We had to send a check with the contract. So you approved the contract back November, December, actually. But we had to wait till we had funding before we could send it to them. We have done that. We'll be waiting on them to execute and get back to us before we can start any additional work. To also let you know, just in case you may hear it, we have had a submission of a utility company or of a telecom company wanting to do work in the same general area. We have told them they have to come to us for a franchise, and in talking to Shauna, basically right before we came to this meeting, their attorney talked to her. She has sent our standard franchise agreement to them, so that is going on. We will be looking at trying to possibly rent some of our space in conduit to them because they want to go the same place we're going. We already have a permit with CSX. Don't know if they do. So it'll be something that will be coming to you probably in the near future. And I'm sure they're going to want to rush that because they've got a construction schedule. Actually, they were wanting to start work, I think, next week, weren't they, Joe? So, But as I've informed them, it is a three reading ordinance. It is a public hearing on that ordinance, so it's not going to happen next week. But I did want to let you know that there is that franchise possibility coming before you.
Yeah, they might want to wait. Here on the side of caution. Mark, you're up.
Yes, sir. The raw water reservoir project we briefly spoke about. It's probably a little over 40% now. At the time of the memo, I think it said 25% of the liner has been installed, but they've made some progress since then. We also discussed earlier tonight the 14-day extensions. Not clear whether they're going to need that 14-day or not. Those 14 days or not, so they seem to be moving along well. The green projects, the West Reclaimed, Downs Boulevard Reclaimed water lines are progressing well.
Are the reclaimed water lines completed?
They're still working on some of the Downs Boulevard reclaimed water line. The West reclaimed is.
Because I don't see those. I see them.
Are those the pink ones?
Yes, the purple, pinkish looking.
They're it may have faded. It's faded in the sunlight.
Yes, those are the yes. The pre-pipe.
They've got to go across West Main there, and it's a state route.
Okay.
Originally, TDOT had required us to bore it, and so they were going to do one bore, and that's probably what they've gotten. I'm not sure how far they've gotten.
They have got one big hole dug over
that's
and
where the
one
pit is.
Big piece yes. of metal stuck over in
that
there.
Is the bore pit.
It's the bore pit.
Okay.
And,
it's the what? Bore middle school?
B-O-R-E, bore pit.
It's by, it's the old wooden table lumber yard is what it is.
Mm-hmm. Really?
Mm-hmm. Almost at
where? I believe it's at West Main and Down.
Yeah, well, that,
the
board
right pit's there. I'm not sure
it's
what's
in another huge hole by Freedom Middle.
That's
that the reclaim?
Freedom.
That was
Middle.
Reclaimed going underneath Highway 96.
Yeah, probably is. It's another bore.
Okay.
They probably chose to wait to bring their bore crews in at the same time.
Okay.
Yeah. Do it all the same.
So that's what. That's why. That's why you've only seen them working on the black water line recently.
And that's further down, but we'll talk about it now. They've started laying that pipe and making progress. No, no problems yet as far as I know on schedule. The clean water projects, Boyd Mill, Country Road, low pressure sewer has been installed. I think they're working through the final bills right now so they can start the resolution process for the assessments. Simmons Ridge, they're doing some site preparation work and should be starting to lay pipe at end of August timeframe. That's moving along well. Southeast Waterline, again, there was a discussion earlier tonight about that. The contract extension due to some issues with the pump station. All the line work has been completed with the exception of right around the booster station area. So moving along there. Monticello, sewer line's in place. The paving is done. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. And I think awaiting some the final change order from the contractor in order to get that resolution process going for
ordinance.
Pardon me?
Ordinance
process. My apologies.
Used to be a resolution.
Yes. Former resolution process. Carter Street, wastewater and water projects. All has been installed and they're working on paving right now. That project has gone really well and the neighborhood's been great. Downs Boulevard waterline, already touched on that one. Franklin Integrated Water Resources Plant. I'm talking very quickly here, so
that's good.
Yellow, okay. The IRP project, there's a stakeholder meeting next Wednesday, the 18th of August. That will be our fourth stakeholder meeting. And
here in what time? Do you remember?
The stakeholder meeting is the group that from the different utility districts, and that's actually going to be
police headquarters.
But that's probably a huge meeting, so we
could
come.
Sure. You can come. Yeah.
Certainly come.
So but that's not the one for us.
It's not the public. It's not the public forum meeting.
It starts at
2:00.
2:00.
2 to 6.
2 to 6
is when we have those stakeholder meetings at the police training center. Certainly welcome to come if you like.
Training center? Community
center? No, it's not the training center. It's the community room and the headquarters.
Community room and headquarters. Make sure you guys aware.
The water, wastewater, and reclaimed water specifications, we had a meeting about that yesterday morning and currently going through the draft that has been presented to us from our consultant. And we've kind of established the schedule and how we're going to review and working through that project right now. We're a little behind, I think. People have been tasked out doing many other things, and so we're going to bring that back on track. Fieldstone Farms Pump Station 2, at the time of this memo was written, they had not yet installed the fencing or done the asphalt for the driveway. I drove by, I'm not sure exactly when they had put it in, but that's right now the fencing's up and the driveway's been placed. So. That one's near completion. I guess we'll soon be awaiting a final change order for that project as well. I think that's it.
Any questions for me? The numbers on the storm water project status reports?
I do want to report to you that we are working on an easement agreement with Christ United Methodist Church for lay down while we're doing the project that is going to increase the cost of the project as far as getting an easement and doing. We're going to be looking at constructing a bridge across Dry Branch for them. However, that increase in cost should save us an overall construction cost savings there that will offset that. But I did want to report to you that we're working on that. We're trying to get all that squared away before we go to bid, because we want all this in the contract as it's bid, as we go to the bid process. So we think we're going to save money by doing what we're adding to the project.
Yeah, we've actually got plans completed, and we probably could have started, or at least had the plan advertised, but we feel like this, working with the church, getting an easement will really help. It'll help the contractor have more room to work to do his dewatering, and it's worth the month or so delay for the savings that we'll get.
Yeah,
the,
if you saw any of the Hill Subdivision Lake work, you saw that we did the dredging and we just put the the spoil material out on the ground to dewater or dry out. We do not have any room at the Jackson Lake area to do that, so we need to go off-site. And what they're going to do is they'll be pumping the dredged material over to the site that they're going to do, and they'll be putting it in big socks. And the socks keep it consolidated, but it does allow it to dry out. And then once that dries out enough, they have to come in with dump trucks, load it up into dump trucks, basically a dry material. Well, to be able to do that, we have to have a bridge across dry branch that is not there now. So, and we're trying to get this bridge set up to where it can be done in conjunction with the ARAP permit that we have for the project itself. In other words, construct the bridge, because anytime you go across the creek, you got to work with TDEC and do ARAPs and things like that.
So who's building this?
The bridge. That's what the delay in the
advertising. The design build thing was.
No, this, we talked about it, but we didn't do it. No. Yes. We're going to go with it. It's going to be it's a design bid build, and we're trying to get all this worked out to where we can put all the construction, the bridge, anything they have to do for the church, et cetera, in the contract itself, where the contractor will be doing it. And it would be part of his bid to do. So that's what we're trying to do. But I did want to bring that to your attention, because it has caused us a slight delay in actually going out to bid for the project itself.
Any other questions of anyone from the committee? And Mike, we'll entertain that famous motion then.
I so move.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye.